You're listening to Bedroom Beethovens, where notable music makers tell their stories on what they sacrifice to create the music you love.
It's just your genuine appreciation on a deep soul level for what artists do. And I love hearing that.
I'm your host, Cello.
What's up? This is J-Rock. And I'm right here. I'm chilling on the Bedroom Beethovens podcast. That's what it is. Let's go.
Hey, everybody. Welcome to episode 184 of the Bedroom Beethovens podcast.
I watched two young men believe in themselves and each other and their music in a way that I've never seen before.
And then I met Chris, and then, shit, life changed right there.
My guest this week is...
My name is Thess One. I suppose most notably, I was one half of People Under the Stairs, who people may or may not know. I never make an assumption. So I was the producer, engineer, you know, one of the rappers with my partner Double K, who tragically passed away last year, or 2 years ago, actually, now. And so we retired in 2019. After 22 years of being on the road and making albums, we made 12 albums. But beyond that, I've done a lot of production work on the side in a lot of different genres. So music's kind of been my career since 1998. This
week, I put the spotlight on California legend Thess One, who, along with his counterpart, partner in rhyme, and musical muse Double K, formed an incomparable group known as People Under the Stairs. And if you follow the band, you will know that after his untimely passing, Thess One honors him with a new project. And in the case of Farewell, My Friend, Thess purposely conceived and sequenced the album to tell the story of their life together. And I do my best to give some insight into who he is, how he grew up, and the journey they went on to what lies ahead. This week, I wouldn't really feel right pitching the extra extremities of the podcast. All I'll say this week is if you're tuning in and you like the show, tell a friend, let's grow the show, because it's allowed a nobody, a lowly hip-hop fan like myself, to talk to all of these juggernaut creatives. So I hope you enjoy the tales you're about to hear. Episode 184 with LA's own Thess One. Yeah, it's funny. I was doing some research for this interview, and I found out that you used to deliver food back in the day before you became a successful touring musician. And because of the pandemic, it's funny how life kind of goes in reverse, where People Under the Stairs retire and the pandemic hits and delivering food is more lucrative than being a touring musician.
Yeah, I mean, that's definitely full circle. Back then, I was delivering food, and I had used a bunch of college loans. I was like diverting money from like my college loan, you know, like when you're in college, you get solicited for all these loans. Everyone wants to loan you money because they know that you're an idiot. You're probably going to take it and then default on it. It's pretty predatory, but, I was taking loans out to fund the manufacturing of our first 12-inch and album. And so then I realized I had to start paying them, and you know, so that's why I was delivering food and working whatever jobs I could. Me and Double K both worked. We both had jobs until we left for tour, pretty much.
People Under the Stairs was formed in 1997, but 1995 you meet Double K at a record store in Pico. That's documented. But that same year you guys became good enough friends where you and your mom went to Las Vegas and he tagged along on the trip. So you guys must have become fast friends. If he's already like joining you on road trips as teenagers.
It was one of those things where as soon as we met, every day after school, we were like bringing things to the table, you know? And when you're a kid like that and you meet someone and you're both really passionate about something, then you don't really want to hang out with other people. You want to like keep going on this deep dive. So you know, every day we were either going through records or listening to hip hop records together, and we were studying production. You know, like, he was the person that basically I could sit down and listen to a record with, and we would dissect what we thought they were doing. I mean, we didn't have anyone showing us. Like, we would listen to a Beatnuts album, and no one was showing us how they would do like a filter on a beat, on a beat miner's production or whatever. Like, we were trying to figure out what they were using, what they were doing. So that was like a daily thing. And then after like a month or two, I was like, hey, we're going to Vegas. You want to roll? And you know, that's how it was. We were friends, but we were also on this journey to try and maybe make music or figure music out together, if that makes sense.
Yeah. So I was about to say, so like this original encounter at this record store, you guys go out to a car and you play beats. And I wasn't sure if it was your car or a friend's, but you play beats to convince who's better.
Yeah.
So when you first meet, it's more like adversaries. And then maybe you guys, your eyes got wide, like, whoa, maybe we're better together. Maybe we shouldn't be adversaries.
Yeah. Like, basically what had happened was, there was, you know, we were going to different high schools. And at his high school, he was like the DJ/producer. And at my high school, I was the only guy like making beats. And when I say making beats, I mean, I had like a computer with a sound card that could loop things, you know, and that's all it could do. And I had gotten a 4-track, and I was able to, like, you know, use a Gemini sampler and loop things on the 4-track. And it, when I met him, it turns out he was doing the exact same thing with a borrowed 4-track. I was using a Tascam and he was using a Fostex, but we were literally doing the same thing. So, you know, it was such a nuanced and weird thing that high school kids weren't doing at the time, that when you meet someone else who's doing it, you know, it was definitely like, whoa. I mean, at first, of course, we were competitive. And when he heard what I was doing and I heard what he was doing, they were different styles. He had more of like a, you know, more, he was sampling like Parliament and more bounce and that on the 4-track. And I was using like Roy Ayers and things like that. But ultimately, you know, we realized that, like, we got to stick together because we're literally the only two dudes doing this shit, you know?
Is that why you were engineering your own records too? Is that just another thing taught out of necessity?
We both had, just funny enough, we both happened to have, individually, before we met each other, we had a 4-track, a cassette 4-track. And for people who don't know, it's basically, it takes a standard cassette tape, and instead of allowing you to record 2 tracks on it, like left and right, you basically can record 4 tracks, 1, 2, 3, and 4 across the tape in one direction. You know, because normally on a cassette tape, you would be doing left and right going one way and then flip it and left and right go the other way. And in this, and with a 4-track, you're basically going 1, 2, 3, 4 all the way in one direction. We had these Gemini samplers, and you could play a record and you could hit start and stop and then trigger it with your hand, or you could loop it. And I think we had like 8 or 10 seconds of sampling on this little button. And so first thing you do, get a drum break, sample that, and then load up the cassette tape and record on track one, start looping the drum break, you know, just looping it. And then find another loop, like a Roy Ayers loop or something like that. And then you would layer it on top of the drum break that you just did. And so once you start doing that, like, at some point you're like, oh, okay, I want to EQ the drums. I want to filter the loop for a second, you know? And so the engineering part of it was almost integrated into it, because you had to be one half engineer to even get like a listenable beat out of it, because it really wasn't designed to do that. You know what I mean? We were taking equipment that existed for home rock demos or whatever, and then turning it into something you can make hip hop beats on. We couldn't afford samplers. Big. I mean, it's like him and I couldn't afford an MPC or SP-1200 at the start, you know?
So that's obviously like the bedroom Beethoven phase. The studio you're in now, is that the same one where you turned the 3-car garage into, or have you moved on from that?
No, I'm still in my studio that's here, but this is like the 4th or 5th iteration of studios that we worked in.
Yeah, because it's funny, it's like, you know, I don't know a lot about equipment, audio equipment or mixing consoles. I'm probably going to butcher the name of this, but I know you had this thing called I think it was a Neve 511-632. It was a mixing console, which is this really behemoth piece of equipment. And I was curious, like, how much did that piece run you? Because I looked online and someone is selling it for $35,000. And I wasn't sure if old production equipment appreciated in price like that. Like, old analog equipment usually doesn't. So it must have been a special piece of hardware.
Ah, it's a piece of shit. You know, it's basically that particular model. It has a sound to it, but, you know, I'm saying this with the perspective of someone who's owned at least 10 or 12 mixing consoles, and I also designed my own console and had a, had one custom built. So I'm not just some dude talking. I'm not a guy on a forum. I'm not a guy on Gear Sluts talking about things I don't know. I know what I'm talking about. And I can tell anyone who's listening right now that a lot of these consoles serve a purpose, but the fact of the matter is the purpose they serve has been eclipsed and outdated by current technology. That's the fact of the matter. Now, a Neve 5116, if you were to buy one for $30,000, you're better off buying a boat anchor because it's a giant hulking piece of gear that needs a ton of maintenance. It sucks electricity up like you would not believe. They're the most inefficient machines ever made. And in doing so, they get really, really hot. And in getting really, really hot, they cook all the capacitors and the resistors. And they're basically, they're for show. They're for someone to walk in and go, oh my God, look at this console. And you go, yeah, man. You know, and people always go, how do you know what all these knobs do? And you go, ah, yeah. But the fact of the matter is you're going to get a much better mixing in the box than on a 5116. And anyone who tells you otherwise or anyone who wants to fight me on it, it's true, dude. It's true.
I hope you got your money back on
so
it.
So I've sold all this stuff.
I was about to ask.
Yeah, I sold it. You know, I sold it for what I bought it for. I think I bought it for like $22,000. I made my own console. I sold that. Because ultimately, at the end of the day, the vast majority of it comes down to the content. It comes down to the song. There's not a lot a mixing console can do to save a not quality content. So, yeah, I had that. I've had a couple Neve consoles. I had an SSL console. I had I've had a custom console, but now I have no console, and I'm still making music. I probably upset a lot of people in a short period of time just now, but you know, I feel like it's almost my duty to be a contrarian voice when it comes to recording equipment, because so many people when I was coming up told me that I needed to have that stuff, and I wasted a lot of time and money chasing it, and a lot of heartache really chasing this stuff, when the fact of the matter was it's not going to change. You know, there's these guys, I'm not going to name names, but there's these guys who like talk about, oh, you know, you got to record analog, you got to record on tape, and it's going to sound better. It's not going to sound better. They're lying. They're lying to you, and they're doing it because they're either insecure about their own music, or they're gatekeeping. They're trying to keep new people from coming in and telling them, no, you can't use just a computer. You got to use, you know, this analog gear or whatever. And it's a sham, dude. It's a lie. These dudes lie.
I think you hear it the most from like, well, why am I going to buy a vinyl if the source was digital? And why am I going to play it on an analog player? I think that a lot of vinyl like snobs kind of get that way too.
Yeah, the vinyl thing is, and this is coming from a guy who not only do I make vinyl, but I apprenticed on a lathe. I'm one of the few guys you probably talk to that knows how to cut vinyl, like literally cut my own vinyl for the newest record. And I'll be the first one to tell you vinyl doesn't sound better. If you want to hear my record, how it was intended to sound, listen to it 24-bit, 44K, or, you know, like, listen to it the way I listened to it when I was in the studio. The vinyl's not going to make it sound better. It's a dub. It's a dub of a digital copy.
Can we just put the bed, like, the rumor where black vinyl sounds better than a color vinyl? It all sounds the same.
Well, no, that's not true. Black vinyl. So traditionally, back in the day, And so it depends who you're buying your vinyl pellets from. But back in the day, black vinyl had lead in it. And the lead content in black vinyl and a little bit of regrind, which means they're recycling other black vinyl that gets used or doesn't get used. So regrind and lead is going to lower the noise floor of your black vinyl substantially. And when the vinyl market imploded, a lot of that same PVC that was being used to make vinyl got used to make catheters and medical equipment. And the EPA was basically like, yo, you can't be putting lead in something in the same plastic that's going to be used for, some of it might go to records, but if some of it's going to IVs and catheters and things like that, yo, it can't have lead in it. When they took the lead out of it, that raised the noise floor by like 6 or 8 dB. So when you, back in the day, black vinyl is always going to sound better than colored vinyl. Nowadays, it's all kind of the same. There's a company in Thailand that makes vinyl pellets called TPC. God, I'm weighing the sticks here, man. Like, you got me nerded out like too far. But yeah, no, black vinyl can and will sound better. The worst sounding vinyl that people are going to use is white opaque. It's the worst sounding vinyl that no one should be using that to press records. That's actual fact. You can measure it.
Or glow in the dark or picture discs, right?
Glow in the dark's even worse. Yeah. Picture disc could be okay because the translucent vinyl honestly has come a long way in terms of noise floor. But we're talking about noise floor here. We're talking about a relative, you know, you're always the level, if you cut a record at +6, the level is always going to be +6. But you're talking about the relative noise floor of when you say how is the vinyl sound. It sounds like the lathe that cut it, the needle that cut it, and it's going to sound like the noise floor of the pressing. So you want to kind of have a combination of those things. And black vinyl will get you definitely closer than other things.
Well, I think you know so much about music on so many different sides because, well, you know, Double K said that that music wasn't an escape from his life because either where he grew up or his home life or drama on the streets, he was surrounded by negativity. Music was his refuge. Was your experience parallel to his? I know you guys went to different high schools, but was music like a beacon of escape for your reality as well at that time?
Definitely. Yeah. Like we were escaping different things, but we weren't like the stars of the football team or some shit. You know what I mean? We were outcasts in our own way, partly because we were so into music. And, where Mike was surrounded by, you know, I mean, look, we both came from loving parents. You know, they did the best for us. They did the best that they could. But it very easily could have gone south for both of us. We made music. Music gave us an avenue to nerd out about, you know. And as you can see, like, I'm just as happy sitting here talking to you for an hour about the formulations of different vinyl PVC pellets. To me, that's part of being a producer. And to Mike, it was part of being a producer, Mike Double K. Like, that's knowing about all this stuff, being able to speak eloquently about everything from David Axelrod to Neve consoles to vinyl pellets. That was what being a producer meant. It wasn't about being cool and getting girls, because we never were that anyways. You know, we were about the music. And so this knowledge was an escape. And we still had that knowledge. You know what I'm saying? Like, learning everything about everything in music, that was the escape.
But generally, you're a good kid, though, because, like, why would your parents force you to go to a prep school?
Because if you knew where I grew up and you knew the people that were my best friends at the time and you were my parents, you'd probably do the same thing. You'd go, this guy is not... either we get him out of here and we get him to an all boys school or he goes to jail.
So they were kind of protecting you, and maybe at the time you didn't appreciate it.
Oh, of course not. I didn't want to go to an all boys school. Who would, you know? It's horrible. They didn't even tell me it was until after I went to the interview and I was like, oh, and they're like, oh, it's a really good high school. And I'm like, oh, okay, cool. You know, the priest at the church got me into it. I'm like, cool, great.
It's crazy because, like, you guys are synonymous with California love. You have so much love for the place you grew up on. But 23 years ago, when you found more success overseas than in your home state, did you start to grow some resentment for the place you called home your whole life? Like, why weren't the people in my own backyard supporting me like these people in Europe 2,000 miles away?
If you live here and you grew up here, this would make sense. But if you didn't grow up here and live here, it's worth noting that LA is a very transitory place that attracts a lot of people for a lot of different reasons. And so when it came to hip hop, a lot of the people that came to LA and were claiming LA were not from LA. And so it made it very easy for them to ignore the people that were here and doing it when they got here, especially when they came in and they were running shit, you know? So a couple of knuckleheads from mid-city or whatever in LA, they, you know, we were very easy to ignore or to sideline. And so we just were like, cool, man. You know, we got in where we fit in. And at first that was in Europe. And then eventually we came back and we did our thing in LA. But when we were out doing stuff in Europe, people still hated on us here.
What about New York? Was that kind of hard too? Because, you know, if you're on a bill with like Houdini and Prince Paul, and I mean, you could have networked, got future collaborations, but maybe New York was just as hard of a crowd to win over as LA, you know? And then also you guys are aligning with the notion that, hey, we're going to make music because we like it. We want to share it with others and we're good at it versus...
Yeah.
Yeah, we, you know, we weren't good at, I mean, we weren't even not good at it. We never networked. We were like, what? You know, like we didn't, that didn't seem like we weren't trying to be famous. We weren't trying to be successful. If we were trying to be successful, then we should have been like reaching out to people, being buddy-buddy, like not speaking our mind, you know, like, hey, oh, hey, yeah. Like, nah, we were like, we're going to make what we make. If you like it, you don't like it. And that's that. We had a very hard time understanding that the industry here in LA was all about like this little get along gang. You got to be cool with everybody. We were from LA, you know, we didn't pull punches. And I do think that it's changed a little bit now because maybe, I don't know, maybe we broke through that a little bit, but I definitely saw it happen with TDE. You know, TDE really was able to break through that. And I mean, they're from Carson for all practical purposes. That whole Ab and all those guys, like they're Carson Compton related, but that's right near where I grew up. And it's a very familiar thing. And I didn't see those guys being all industry. Like when they were selling mixtapes over by the IKEA in Carson, like that was like, I was like, okay, this is real. Like they're not catering to Hollywood. They're doing it their way. And so that to me is a real LA way. You do, you know, and that's not what people who moved here were doing. People who moved here were like networking and they're out in these gentrified communities, like doing DJ gigs and stuff. And we were like, man, I'm at home with my girl and my family and my dog, you know, we're from LA. This is home.
From like just a human nature aspect, like, you know, 20 years ago when you're on even footing with Will I Am and you see that he takes off De La Soul and Jurassic 5 on his album and he adds like Papa Roach and Justin Timberlake and Fergie. And next thing you know, he's on The Voice and all this. You got to do music the way you wanted to. So there's no like, ah, oh, man, we could have got Katy Perry on a hook and we would have been right there with them. There's none of that.
No, that's the networking that I'm talking about. That's the quote unquote smart business that we never cared to participate in, to our own detriment, probably, you know, like who knows, maybe if we got like a girl to sing on our tracks or whatever, like maybe we could have had plaques on the wall right now. But the fact of the matter is we were knuckleheads. We still are. And we weren't going to do it that way. You know, we were too OG LA to cater to that kind of thing. Now, Will is from LA too, man. I'm not saying Will isn't, but Will had a very different perspective of I think how he saw himself and how he saw himself being famous, you know? And to us, to me and Double K, we measured our success differently. We measured our success by our ability to make music that made us happy, made the homies happy, and money or recognition or fame was never the intent when we made the music in the first place.
It's almost kind of a catch 22 because you're an indie act, so it's DIY. So yeah, the music you make is yours, and you've traveled to 6 continents, thousands of shows, 20 years of touring, but you were also the driver on those tours and the manager, and you handled the finances and you organized the mail and the websites, the wardrobe, the merch. So now every time that you release a record, you know, a normal artist on a label might have to do an interview on Jimmy Fallon. But when you finish an album, you're probably thinking, ah, man, we have to drive to these locations. We have to press up stickers and mugs and vinyl and shirts and figure out how much profit we make per vinyl. And if this plant gives us a good deal and a million other things. And I can see how the business side of art can probably make you want to quit at sometimes.
I mean, yeah, for sure. Like, that's why I know so much about vinyl formulations. But it also we never saw it otherwise. We never saw it as doing it any different because we never wanted someone to tell us what to do. Look, we're probably the only group that I know of that every single record we ever made, there was not a single other person in the room. Never, not once. The only person in the room when any of this music got made was me and Double K. We engineered it, we made it, we recorded it, we tracked it ourselves in a room together because we never wanted, like, we didn't even want a tracking engineer sitting there telling us, nodding his head and being like, oh, that's really great. We just saw it as a hurdle to honesty. And so when it was me and him in there, we could get open. And then, you know, following that through, then we would take it to our mastering engineer, someone we trusted, like my man Pete. And then we would take it to manufacturing. But it was kind of a control thing, you know. And I grew up in Pedro. I grew up watching the Minutemen. I was very inspired by a lot of punk groups that I grew up surrounded by. And their whole ethos of, you know, we jam a Kano, we control our tours, we sell merch at the merch table after the show. that's how I grew up. That's what I grew up around. That's what I wanted to do in hip hop. You know, I didn't want to be that guy that just got on the tour bus and told his fans to fuck off and left. You know, we were there, man. People know we were at the bar with them.
Yeah, I guess from what I'm getting to is like your story is very similar to almost everyone I interview. They're so passionate about the music. It's almost the common thread that connects everyone I talk to. Like music is the only thing I'm good at. Music is the only thing I'm interested in. I'm going to make music until I physically can't. I'll be 90 years old and I'll still make music. But for you, you actually officially retired years back. What brought upon that decision?
You know, we always had a plan and we always curated the arc of our catalog. We didn't want to be curated by the fans. We didn't want to be curated by someone else. We wanted to start it and end it on our own terms. And one of the best ways you can do that is before you die, say, this is my last album, and write your last song and record it and put it out. And thank God we did that because, you know, a year and a half later, Mike died. But we were able to do it and we did it on our own terms. And so, you know, like the reason why we retired People on Stairs was because we had our run, you know, like we did everything we set out to do as a group. There was nothing left for us to do. There was nothing left for us to rap about. We were done. So we wanted to end on our own terms.
Yeah, I'm so glad to hear that because I appreciate longevity in music. And I think a good example is the guy who mixed your record. You talked about it on the house list. His career started before you were even born. And literally in his late 50s, he finally opened up a studio. And like a few years ago, he could have rode off in the sunset a long time ago. I mean, he did the Rolling Stones, James Brown, Aerosmith, Willie Nelson, and now Thez One, you know? I'm excited for that because even though he won Grammys with Coldplay and John Mayer, well, now he's hearing Headnodic's bass guitar. He's hearing Kat and Max, and maybe he's like, oh, I've never heard anything like this. So now he's listening to Crown City Rockers, and he's listening to your old stuff. So that stuff gets me excited.
Yeah, it's cool. I don't think he gives a shit. Let's be honest.
You're popping my fantasy over
here. No, yeah, I'm going to shut that down right now. It's a transactional thing, but it was necessary for me to do because I wasn't going to be able to. That was the first time I ever had someone mix something I made, ever, in 24 years or whatever. And I had to do it because I was too emotionally vested in that particular project to finish it. So, you know, it had to go to Brower. And, you know, if I had to pick someone to mix it, obviously it would have been Michael Brower. And I'm glad that he was able to do it. But I don't think Michael Brower thinks about it anymore. I don't think he woke up today and was like, damn, that record was sick. You know, I'd love to think that, but, you know, I'm just pragmatic about it. Like I don't think that's the case. And I'm not retired from music either. It's just that, and Mike wasn't going to retire from music. We were just putting a footnote or ending People on the Stairs. We were going to close the chapter on that on our own terms. You know what I'm saying? We didn't want, I mean, look, man, there's a lot of groups. There's a lot of people that they make a record and then for whatever circumstances, that's their last record. And there's no thought that goes into it. So we wanted to make a quote unquote last record.
I think I read somewhere though that actually said the opposite, where it said that you created Sincerely the P. You went into it not knowing it was going to be like the retirement record. Was that incorrect?
No, that's not true. We knew. In fact, the two records prior to it are called the Getting Off Stage 1 and 2, because, you know, it's a triple entendre that Mike came up with. Basically, you know, it's the getting off stage that hurts, meaning we're physically in pain, getting off stage literally physically hurt, but also walking away from this hurts. And it's the getting off stage, meaning like you're getting off stage and it's the stage which you're getting off at and all those sort of things. But the whole reason the final record is called Sincerely the P is because that's how you would sign a final letter, you know? And the songs that we wrote for that record, I wrote a song dedicated to my son. He basically wrote a song saying goodbye to everyone. And that's the last song on the record called Sound of a Memory. And that's it, you know? And we closed the chapter.
So just to clarify, like if you had a crystal ball and you knew your time together would be cut short, would you guys have mashed the gas pedal? Or regardless of what happened, that's still a great stopping point for you guys?
When you say mash the gas pedal, what do you mean?
Let's just keep going until the wheels fall off.
No.
Or is it better to have or?
No. You don't. No, you're not understanding. So our whole career, like we have an album called 12 Step Program that came out in 2012. Yeah. So anyways, 12 Step Program means that our program is going to have 12 steps in it. And Sincerely the P was the 12th album. The whole thing was planned out. The whole thing was thought out from the very beginning. There was not like, we weren't, there was no more to do. Like, we're like, okay, we made it to the 12th album. And so this is the 12th album and this is the final album. If I knew Mike was going to die, we wouldn't have made a 13th album. You know what I mean? Like, that was the intent. We accomplished what we said we were going to do, that we set out to do, which was make 12 albums. That's the 12-step program.
I was blown away by like to have the foresight to map out a career and then see it to fruition and then actually honor that sight. I think that's rare.
That was how we set it out for ourselves, you know? And again, you can do that when your goal is not success. You can do that when your goal is to create an extended piece of art that is self-referential, which is all of our albums. They all link back to each other in different ways. So we were just, in one way, we wanted to look at our entire catalog as a contiguous art piece, you know, that is, it's 12 albums, but it might as well be one long one too, if that makes sense.
Yeah, if you're not chasing like the money and all the monetary value, you definitely said that you were addicted to the possibility of what's next. So as that slows down, that might have been bittersweet too. Like, you didn't know that, you know, like The Simpsons is going to call, or this opportunity is going to come, or this. I guess it's that unknown byproduct of what you guys make, you know. Yeah. Because, you know, this last few weeks, you must have gotten 1,000 DMs, 1,000 text messages, people who probably you haven't heard from in years. Maybe it was job offers to go back on the road or renewed interest in your music again. Chemically speaking, there's probably an endorphin rush. Like, you probably felt the same rush back when you originally said that quote of being addicted to the possibility of what's next.
Yeah. I mean, there is, but you know, that's why we had to say the last album was the last album. Because if that's really true, like, we didn't want to be like the guy that retires and then comes back, you know? I mean, it happens. There's a lot of athletes that make a big deal about their retirement and then they come back and everyone goes, oh God, you know, the hardest thing about saying that something's the last thing. Well, there's a lot of very difficult things about saying something's going to be your last album and then making it. One, you have to know that you're walking away from a lot of possibilities, a lot of opportunities to make money touring or otherwise. But two, you have the added weight of knowing that something is the finality of it, that it really is, you know, the last thing. And so when you're making it, that's weighing on you. It's a very hard thing to wrap your head around. But yeah, we had to close the door and we had to say no more possibilities, no more Simpsons, no more this, no more that. We gotta say that's it, you know. And whoever calls, we'll pick up the phone and kindly thank them, but we are not interested.
So when you say that people under the stairs retire, but Thez One hasn't, you also said something interesting where you said that Double was the casual control and you have a lot of energy and nerves. And when you get together, it's the combination of the two that makes it happen. So you don't try to do hip hop by yourself, because when you're doing hip hop, you're thinking People Under the Stairs or you're thinking Double K, which is great. And this album kind of proves that there is a future where you're capable of doing both to great acclaim. Or, you know, at the end of the day, if you can't make music with Double K, even if it's for Double K, you're just not interested. Like, which is it? Like, for, I guess, the future of your career, are you going to stray more away from hip hop? Or was this album something like, you know, this is something that I didn't know I had the strength to do, and I like this place?
I don't know. You know, I got to think about that. And that's just going to take time to figure out, you know. Like, creatively, I obviously have a lot more to give, but I don't want to do anything hip hop wise without Mike. And so there's a lot of, you know, it's a very painful thing to try and envision doing it without him. And so I don't really know yet, you know. I don't know. I mean, I'm still going to make beats because that's something that I always did. You know, production is something that I do on a daily here in the studio. But in terms of actually getting all the way through to a release and then promoting it and all that, that's a lot more arduous of a task. It's going to be a lot harder to see what I'm doing. I mean, I don't know if I'll ever rap again, you know. We'll see.
Well, this 12 album run that we just talked about, this original run, you exclaimed that it never stops being overwhelming, emotional, and scary. Farewell, my friend. I'm going to assume it was overwhelming. I'm going to safely assume it was emotional. But what about that last element? Were you scared to start this project? And maybe when it was finished, were you scared to release it?
I wasn't interested in people's opinions on it. I wasn't interested in promoting it. all of the mechanical and rote tasks that you have to do to do a release in 2023, I wasn't interested in any of that. And not the least of which, I wasn't interested in making money off of it or in getting any sort of acclaim for it. I just needed to do it for myself. And so once it was done and it was here, I was done. And, you know, I'm glad it came out, but I was very close to not even putting it out, if that makes sense.
It must have helped, though, having your friends and peers, like having Headnodic on bass. I'm sure he added elements, emotional elements that he brings to the record, his skill set, or having Kat on the keys. So that must have helped from an emotional standpoint.
Yeah, except they didn't know what I was doing when they did it.
Oh, no kidding. I didn't know that. So you kind of build it like a mystery project.
Yeah, I mean, like I told Ethan that I was working on a project for Mike. But in terms of it being a tone poem and all of the high level stuff, I didn't really share it with them because I didn't want it to taint their contribution, or I didn't want it to get in their head about what they were playing or what they were doing. So I had an idea of what I was doing, but they didn't know.
I think I've been roped in since the beginning of UTS, People Under the Stairs. For this one, I remember calling up this and saying, hey, I'm going to go to NAMM. I'm going to be in LA. And he was like, I'm going to get a studio. Let's record. And then he didn't tell me what it was for until afterwards.
And then I edited it in a way that it, you know, that then it made sense for the overarching theme about it being a tone poem and whatnot.
After I called him up, he was like, that was the push for him to get started on this tribute album. And so when I went there, it was like a whole nother level of focus. I remember I did start like meditating before these sessions, and it was just like one of those, like, I'm so glad I started doing that prior so I can like get into it. Cause there was a lot of times where I just remember, I like, honestly, a lot of times I'm playing, I don't know what I'm playing. So I'm just hoping that whoever's listening has the producer ear to pick out yes or no. And Thess is awesome with that. Like, he really picks out the takes and the takes that really make me feel like, what am I trying to say? He makes me feel like I sound like I think I sound.
Let's start real quick with the intro.
Okay.
It was meant to be. That's you on the piano, yes?
Yes. Oh, and his mama. Oh, my gosh. Oh, my gosh.
Chris and Mikey created the perfect blueprint to follow. You guys really did. You know, the way you did it, the independence, where you know what, because when you believe in something, when you listen to your spirit and you know what God has given you and you act on it, it's gonna be successful. That's why I said there was no room to say, wow, what if we didn't, you know, what if it didn't happen?
I got roped in because there was one beat that Thess sent my way, the aeroplane joint, the Mike, Chris, and Too Many Aeroplanes. Okay. And I was like, what is that? That is a killer sample that is like haunting and like beautiful. Wow. And had, you know, a little bit of the history of PUTS in it, which after that last record, there's so much emotion. Just watching the story, the arc of what they completed and how they went out on that last note, you know, of that last album they did. There's such a depth to everything. Once this track came, it was like I knew Mike had passed, and it, there was a depth that I wanted to honor that, the bond that they have, and not just to do something for Mikey, but also for Thess. Like, I know he needed it. I know he needed the space to put the pain on tape and kind of go through it. And also, you know, like, if he doesn't, then he doesn't make music anymore. He's got to go through this. It's like the walking through fire thing.
Like, I still wasn't planning on, at a certain point, like last December, I'd come in here and listen to it. And I'd be like, okay, great. Wasn't going to put it out though. You know, I just couldn't bring myself to finish it. And I just didn't care if people heard it. I'm glad it came out, but like it was very close to never coming out.
I had a beautiful time trying to interpret my ideas of what he's going through, which isn't altogether that difficult because I knew Mikey as well. And also in that same time, I lost my bandmate, Gift the Gab, my homie, and we all lost Steve Zumbi from Zion Eye. Mm-hmm. And right around that time, too, my dad passed. Mm-hmm. So there was like a whole bunch going on. Kat, I know you were swimming in grief and as well. So I think it was this cathartic exercise and possibility to jump into this project and really try to see his vision through and honor his experience and his bond with Double K. Because it's profound. They've been together. You know, it's like all of Crown City Rockers, you know, losing all y'all. Yeah. It's the two of them, you know? So it's just this yin and yang thing that's like now just incomplete.
Right.
And I think this album was taking that symbol and trying to create something else out of it. And what it ended up being is explaining the story of, you know, their entire experience and ends up being this beautiful ride. And let me just say, when I first finally heard the album, I was like, oh boy, here we go. Pour myself a bourbon. And then I walked back to the studio to press play and I was like, this is going to be hard. This is going to be difficult. Press play and was taken aback by the end of the project. It's filled with so much joy and so much,
the celebration of it. Yeah.
It's the celebration of their story. It's the celebration of his life. It's the celebration of their bond. And it really feels like a celebration. There's hard moments and as there is in life, but it focuses on what you want to focus on, which is the beauty in life. So to start this off, it was meant to be. When I heard those chords, I don't solo on the bass. You know me. I'm the weak link of Crown City Rockers.
No, Max
run circles around me. But you know, had these simple piano chords that just had so much emotion to them. I was like, oh, I hear a melody, and I just started playing and dialed in like this what to me is beautiful, this bass piece. Over the top of those beautiful chords. And then when I first heard the song played back to me, I heard Mike's mom on it and had no idea that was going to be the case.
I had no idea either.
That goes every hour. So
what is that?
It's the church around the corner. Every hour the bell goes, it lets you know the time.
That's the thing with this. I mean, in my perspective, like, I've been doing a lot of tracks with this and just, you know, just a lot of collaboration with them. And it's like, always, I never know what it's going to be. Always. I'll do my best to be, you know, the puppet of his musical thoughts. And I just never know what it's going to be. And I listened, the first time I pressed play, when he sent me the album to listen to it, I had it queued up and I was on a plane with my kids next to me and I'm like, oh gosh, let's do it. And just bawling on the plane like from the get, and then going through the whole like the whole journey. But then I never knew that there were going to be no vocals on it, you know, other than his mom and the interview snippets. I was just like, because I mean having an instrumental album out there, it says a lot if it's instrumental, you know? And it's like, I wasn't ready for like, wow, okay, cool. And then I listened to it again with that in mind, and it was a whole different journey for me, you know? Mm-hmm. And actually the cool thing about it is like, the more you listen to it, the different parts of the journey you see, and everything had a meaning to it. And And it was just, it was amazing to see how Thess crafted this.
In People Under Stairs, Mike was like the guy that would tell me to, like, you know, just move on. Like, it's cool. Like, do it for the funk. Like, just release it. And so without having that person in my life, you know, that was hard to finish anything, because I would just perpetually, like you said, like, just kick it over and start over again. But also because, you know, finishing a record like this that's dedicated to someone who died, it also means that you're, when you finish it, you're not working on it anymore. And if you're not working on it anymore and it's finished, that means you're kind of acknowledging it. And I don't know if I was particularly ready to ever acknowledge that he was gone. I mean, I still have nightmares at night where, like last night, I had a nightmare where, like, I thought he was, like, in my dream. And it was a very real dream. It felt real that I felt like he was, I found out he was still alive. And this whole thing was like a hoax. And I was really mad at him. And I've had this dream like a lot, actually, where I'm really upset at him in my dream, because I find out in my dream that he didn't die and that he's like hiding. And I'm like, man, the fans are going to be so upset. And I made this whole record for you. And, you know, so I'm still dealing with stuff like that. I'm still dealing with a lot of, you know, I think PTSD and other issues unaddressed from it that I don't even know about.
And those chords, yeah, they are haunting chords. They're such haunting chords, but so beautiful. And I just, like, he played the track. He was like, can you replay this? And once I figured out the chords, it was just like, oh, beautiful, beautiful chords. But yeah, never knew that it was going to be the beginning to this album.
So 90s Mike and Chris on the Porch. I loved when he sent me that one, because I recorded.
Oh, this is cool. This is cool. This beginning of this one, 90s Mike. Okay, so there's a piano in there. And then there was also, oh my God, what was it called? The Omni chord? Was it the Omni chord where it's like an electronic, like, little teardrop of an instrument where you press metal sensors for chords, and then you strum across another set of metal sensors. Such a funny instrument. A lot of, like, rock bands use it, but using it on this, trying to find chords on it for this was like, I had to stretch my brain to take out, like, I had to, like, simplify it to its, like, simplest form of those chords and find it on this Omni chord. It was fun. That was cool. Mm.
Yeah, when I heard that sample, I was like, it's the unmistakable Beat Nuts sample. Oh, yeah. You know, they grabbed that from a Monty Alexander record, or from Love and Happiness.
Oh, yeah. That's
right?
Yes. Because there's Jamaican roots, man.
Yep. There you go. So, I got so excited doing that one that I did a full replay at the end of it, just because I wanted to, like, play guitar on it and play, like, percussion and shit. Yeah. You never used any of it, but it was, like, kind of a fun exercise to kind of...
Oh, man.
I was like, in case he wanted, like, just the guitar or whatever. Because there was no guitar player, you know, at that point when he hit me up. I think he hit me up as the first person he was roping in, and I think he knew you were coming in.
Yeah.
But yeah, so I just had, I got my rocks off and just played a bunch of different.
Yeah. You know what's interesting? I would be interested to hear all of the what was not used, because there was so much recorded, but so much was not used.
Oh, yeah. I kept some fun stuff. What's that one? Let's see. Mike and Chris's Bachelor Party in Rosarito. That joint I played. Fun. Like several different solos on. I just had so much fun on those chords. None of it made the tape. It's fine. I enjoy just, watching it.
It's just, that is just such a fun beat. Oh my gosh. Exactly. Yeah. All of these synthesizers, we were just, that's what we were doing. We're just, like, going through it, just, like, having a party, like, let's try this one. Let's try this CS80. What does this do? How does this work? Does it sound good with the track? No? Okay, next. Then we would just, like, move on to, like, different synthesizers. I think the CS60 actually did. That's the...
That's just a bunch of numbers to me. I don't know what you're talking about.
These are synthesizers.
But yeah, there's so much joy in that track. I would love to have been a fly on a wall at the Bachelor Party.
Oh my gosh. Yeah.
Thank you.
And okay, so the other musicians that I played with in the studio were Mikhail and Paul Caruso. Chops Caruso. And Mikhail was like one of those like all around musicians who can play lots of instruments.
Sweet. What about Max McVitie?
And Max McVitie, oh my gosh, when he came in, I think this was the first one that he was like, can you play to this one? And of course, Max just walks in with his like kombucha and his sticks and sits at the drums and starts like press play, and he's already like in there. That's great.
So I wasn't in the studio, so I wasn't there when you guys recorded Survivor Syndrome. We did it for Mikey.
Yes.
That sounds like, at the end, it just sounds like a sweet moment of joy and kumbaya for coming together and completing it. It sounds like you did it last.
We just did do it last.
The feeling of it.
Of course we had to do it last.
How did it feel to know that that was the end of the project and you weren't playing another note after that?
Oh my gosh. Well, first of all, that was the one song that we all played live together. So all the band recorded it all at once, which was a great feel. Great, great feel. Then it was the end of the night. We all get around, we all have our headphones and we're all in a circle. Like we get this awesome room mic that sounds better than real life itself. And like, it was just at that time I had started drinking because I was like, okay, I'm not going to drink until like we're kind of finished with the projects. And I was already kind of getting sloshly. But everybody's energy and everybody singing at the same time, it was so beautiful. It was our own, like, it was the circle song, which was like, we all needed to be there for each other. We all needed to like sing it out for each other. You know, like this, nobody had been able to like be in a group setting like this for a long time. And like, it was a nice release when everybody, that was a nice release. That was a very, very, very nice. There was a couple of takes where it was just like, oh yeah. But you know, oh, what a time.
We did it for Mikey. You and I did it for Thess and Mikey. And,
yes.
I appreciate getting roped in.
I know, me too. We did it for everybody. Everybody. Yeah. I think the world needs this.
Yeah. I'm glad Thess got in there, did this album, and hope he keeps going and makes more good music. And hope that he ropes me in continuously, because I love playing with the dude.
Yeah.
And then on top of that, you know, there's a lot of other stuff along the way that has both haunted the recording of it, the mixing of it, all the way up until the vinyl, cutting the vinyl. The first pressing of the vinyl had unexplained airplane noises on it. I went back to recut the vinyl a couple days ago, and the audio cut out while we were cutting it, ruining the entire, for no reason. It's never happened before. Things like that, like they just keep happening over and over and over again. And I don't believe in that shit. So I'm like, it would be very easy to be like, oh, okay, Mike's messing with me. But I swear, man, this stuff just keeps happening. I believe that this podcast shut off about halfway in or a quarter of the way in. And you didn't really know why or why that. So that anytime something's being recorded and I'm talking about Mike or people on the stairs or shit like that happens. And it's fucking exhausting, dude. You know, like, can you imagine every time you're trying to do something, like just the audio shuts off or, you know, see, that's the thing. I don't attach like a bad or good to it. I just have to acknowledge that it happened. Like what happened with us recording this podcast. We just have to acknowledge that it happened. You know, it's bugged out, man. It's really bugged out.
But I read the LA Times, the last article they did. I read the article. I learned some things I didn't know beforehand, which, in their words, they stated that Double K died from alcohol poisoning, and they linked that alcohol poisoning to poor health choices while touring, while being a member of People Under the Stairs, you know? And I thought that was kind of heavy. Like, do you view music as sort of a fickle mistress where it's given you everything in life fame, a purpose, a best friend, a legacy, but it also took some of that away as well. Like, you know, I know you had a 12 album vision, but maybe if you retired after six albums instead of 12, okay, the Roy Ayers stuff is done. OST is done. Maybe it would have saved. I know it's a thin line to do the coulda, woulda, shoulda, but before you recorded this album, were you jaded on music? Like, did you hate what music had done, what touring had done, what the grind of a DIY artist had done?
We always knew that the amount of effort and just the work we were putting in, you know, like the way we were touring, the amount of effort we were putting in, the running the merch table after the show and all that sort of stuff, we knew it was physically wearing us down. And towards the end of that run, you know, after being on the road for 22 years, it's physically taxing, and it was taxing on Mike and me in different ways. But I do think that we were okay with it because we knew that there was a finish line, and that was the last record. And when we got to the last record and we finished Sincerely the P, I think we both felt like, wow, we made it. You know, we were both convinced that we were going to die on the road at some point, because you can't travel that much. You can't, the odds are that you're going to get in an accident. And we never did. We never got in a tragic accident or anything like that. Even though every time we went out on the road, the odds increased that it was going to happen. And even though we were being physically worn down by it, by the time we got to the end, there was a sense of relief. Like, we made it, you know, we made it. We made it to the point that we promised ourselves we would make it to. We promised the fans we would make it to the end. We lost a lot of people along the way, but we made it. And so I was okay with it. But then when Mike died after that, you know, yeah, I think there was probably some resentment, but not too much, because I felt like we knew what we were doing in the time, if that makes sense. I was at peace with it. We were both willing to die for hip hop. What really bothers me is when we don't get acknowledged now for that sacrifice. Like, two nights ago, when they had the Grammys, they had this board in the back with all these names on it. And People Upstairs wasn't on that board. Now, that's not surprising to me. It doesn't shock me anymore. But at the same time, that shit hurts, because Mike died for this shit, you know? And to see us not get that recognition and not be treated with the respect or the, you know, just the recognition, really, I mean, this is hip hop. So it's all, a lot of it comes down to respect. We didn't get money out of it. Then it kind of feels like he died in vain a little bit. And that bothers me. That makes me upset. Like, I got unreasonably upset about the fact our name wasn't on that list when other people's names were on that list. And I'm like, man, you know, I'm not trying to throw shade at nobody, but damn, these people, this dude, this group does not belong up here if we're not up there. It's great. I believe everyone deserves to be acknowledged. I just don't know why it's always at the sake of ignoring People on the Stairs. And I do think that people have gone out of their way to erase our history in hip hop because it doesn't fit the mold, and it basically forces people to think about hip hop from a punk standpoint. And that is to the detriment of the industry. You know what I'm saying? Like, they don't want everyone going the People on the Stairs route. They don't want people being independent. They don't want people owning their masters, selling their merch, you know? So it's convenient for them to write us out of history, for sure.
I hope you don't mind me disclosing, but to mount even more pressure, like, why are you recording this? Like, your father was going through chemo and you got COVID. Both of you guys came out the other side, thank God. But with that said, the outpour of love from this record, maybe has the path become clear on what you want to do next? Because life is fragile. And this is just me selfishly saying, but I think you need music and music needs you. And I just hope you keep going forever and forever.
Well, I appreciate that. Well, we'll see, you know. I don't really know, you know, like, right now for me, it's like one foot in front of the other. Like, I gotta make sure these records get pressed correctly and that they sound good and that there's not phantom airplane noises on songs. And I'm going to get through that and I'm going to get them shipped out to the fans. But beyond that, you know, we'll see, man. I don't really know. That's one thing for sure is, like, after everything that's happened, I'm trying not to make plans. I don't want them to get ruined. I had too much disappointment.
You know, I was kind of curious too, is, like, you know, the picture that you chose, like, he's not looking at you. He's kind of looking at the ground. Well, what was that kind of the creative decision?
I basically had, so there was this day that we took those photos and Mike was running a little late down to get the photos done, and he had grabbed that necklace that he's wearing, which was his mom's necklace, and she's like a dread, you know, but she became a dread when it wasn't really cool to be a dread, you know. It was actually like in LA at that time, it wasn't considered a cool thing, you know, to be a young black woman with dreads. It was a burden, you know, and it was a sign of defiance in a sense. And when he was a kid, you know, I'm sure people would make fun of that or whatever, but also he wanted to show the people he was around that he wasn't into gang banging and gang shit. And so he would steal that necklace from his mom when he was a kid and wear it, you know, like just, hey man, like I'm like a Rasta, like I'm into hip hop. And he showed up that day with the necklace, and we were like, yo, what's the deal? You know? And he's like, he told us the story behind it and that he wanted to wear it in the photos. And in that photo, he had just like finished talking about it. And he's looking down at the necklace. And so that's like a photo of him looking down at his necklace that he took from his mom. And so, you know, it's very like everything on the record. There's a lot of layers to it. There's a lot of meaning that transcends just what it looks like from afar. I mean, from afar, it's a cool picture, but there's a whole story behind it. You know what I mean?
That's one, Chris. It was an absolute honor to speak with you today. And we can kind of now cement this legacy via long form audio, and I'm honored to be included in that. So God bless. Thank you so much.
Yeah, I appreciate it. I appreciate it, man. I appreciate you giving me the opportunity to talk about it. I apologize if I sound edgy to anybody out there. You know, it's just it's been a very overwhelming period of time, but I do stand behind all this stuff. And going back to like the audio thing, you know, where we started this conversation, like if there's a kid out there and he hears this and he's like, you know, I'm just making music on my computer, but like, I feel a certain way about that because I'm not recording in a big studio, or I'm not recording, you know, analog or this or that. I want to tell that kid, and I want that kid to know that you don't need it. You know, like if me and Mike had never just done it, then we wouldn't even be having this conversation. You know, it's being DIY, basically being a bedroom producer and moving on, it changed our lives. And I want to see that for more people, whether the industry recognizes them or not, whether their name ends up on that Grammy wall, none of that shit matters. If you do it and you do it with your heart, you know, there's no stopping. Like, that's what I want everyone else out there to know. That's what I wish someone would have told me. I mean, I'm glad we lucked into it, but yeah, I never needed to buy any of those recording consoles, man.
Yeah, if you're sitting on a Neve mixing console, go sell it and buy your mom something nice. You heard
sell
it
that first. Shit. Sell that shit, man. You know, pay for your father's chemotherapy.
Do it for Mikey. We did it for Mikey.